for you. So go home, go
thank you.
to heaven. I just wanna make it in. I just wanna cross the river.
My Lord,
I wanna be free from sin. Oh, oh, oh. I just want my name written. Oh, Lord. Written in the Lamb's book of life. Yeah, yeah. And when this life is over, I just wanna have eternal life.
Good morning. Praise the Lord. And welcome to a celebration of life for Emmanuel Babatunde Durosomo. We are so pleased that you could make it. And it is our heart that we serve you during this time, that you have an opportunity to reflect, to grieve, to feel the presence of God. And with that, leave this place having done your final fellowship with him in that way, in a corporate setting. We will start with song, and so our worship leaders will come and at this time, and we will start with song. Lord. Glory, hallelujah. The presentation of a prayer of comfort is coming from our prayer coordinator, Sister Tawana Benjamin.
Praise the Lord. I think it would be fitting for everybody but the family, unless you want to stand, if we can just stand to our feet. You know, I just want to welcome the presence of the Lord, and let's exalt the one who we're going to pray to for comfort. Amen. He's King of Kings and He's Lord of Lords, and He can do anything. So, you know, when we grieve and when we need comfort and whatever we need, we can go to God for it. So that's the one I want to lift up right now. Amen. Before I do that, I just want to give honor to the church here. You know, I don't know if Brother Beardsley's here anywhere. And, you know, my pastor and my church that's here and the family, you know, thank God for you. Amen. Amen. So let's worship the Lord right now. Before we ask God for comfort, let's just worship the Lord. Jesus, God, I lift you up right now, Lord. I thank you for this wonderful opportunity, Jesus, to exalt you in this place, Lord. God, I release you, Lord. I thank you, Jesus. I worship you, Lord. I worship you, Lord. I worship you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus, for your presence, Lord. God, I thank you for your spirit, Lord. I thank you, Lord, for every person that in this place, Jesus. Lord, I thank you for them, and I ask you, God, to have your way right now, Jesus. God, that you begin to impact them, Lord, that you touch their hearts, Lord. God, begin to massage their hearts and their minds, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for what we get through your spirit, Lord. It's only through your spirit, Jesus. For you are the one, Lord, who is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think, Lord, according to the power that worketh in us. Thank you, Jesus, for the power that resides in this room, Lord. God, I thank you, Jesus. I thank you for the abundance of all things, Lord. And right now, Lord, just begin to touch the family, Lord. Begin to minister, Lord, in a way, God, that you've never ministered before. Begin, Lord, to speak, Lord. God, have your way and minister through your spirit. We release you, Lord, in an awesome way. God, that people would leave here changed today, Lord. God, that they would encounter you in a different way, Jesus. For there's power through your spirit, Lord. Oh, there's comfort through your spirit. We can rest in your spirit, Lord. Thank you so much, Jesus. And God, just be very personal today, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Your name is the sweetest name that I know. Oh, God, I thank you, Jesus, that I can lift you up and magnify you, God. I thank you, Jesus. You're King of Kings and Lord of Lords. You're all glorious, Jesus. I magnify you, oh God. I thank you, Jesus. I thank you, Lord, for the time that we had with Brother Babatunde. I thank you for the impact, Lord, upon the church. I thank you for the impact upon the lives of his family members, Lord, for the impact upon the lives of his people, Lord, his co-workers, the city, Lord. Oh, God. God, we never know, Jesus, what our lives are doing, Lord, if we just let our light so shine. Lord, the lives that we impact, Lord, through your spirit, as you minister, Lord, as you reach. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. I say thank you, Jesus. I thank you, Lord, for your presence. Thank you for every person here, Lord. Thank you, God. I worship you, Jesus. And God, as we leave this place, oh God, continue, Jesus. Let this be monumental for somebody, Lord. Continue, Lord, to minister, Lord, as we leave this place. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for the hope, God. Thank you for the hope we have in you, Lord, through your Holy Spirit, Lord, through your blood. I thank you for the hope. Thank you, Jesus. My brother had that hope. Thank you, Jesus. We can celebrate his life. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Praise your glorious name. Praise your glorious name. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. There's all power in your name. Oh, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. All glories in your name. You're a soon coming King. Thank you, Jesus. Now, God, do what only you can do. Do what only you can do through your Spirit, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Just rest upon this place. God, just rest upon this place. Thank you, Jesus. Have your way, Lord. Have your way, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. And everybody say, in Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. You may be seated. Thank you, Sister Benjamin. Hallelujah. Glory, hallelujah, glory, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Family, we thank you so much for trusting us with this service. There are a number of us that are just a little tender about this. This guy, and I'm not putting it in a vernacular, but this guy was one of a kind. He was a public servant and humble. Those two rarely go together. Because as soon as someone counts you as, quote, a dignitary or someone that is accomplished, we begin to feel some things about ourselves, and unless we tamp that down, we'll never find humility. But we're talking about a guy that left the offices of the mayor, came to Bible study on Thursday night, and after service was over, grabbed a vacuum cleaner and a broom and helped us clean the sanctuary, because that's what he wanted to do. That's who we're talking about. I wonder if President Obama picks up the vacuum cleaner every now and then. Or anyone, you know, have we risen above the ability to clean a bathroom because we've become accomplished? You see, there's something to be said for humility. It is not overrated. Hallelujah. And I give honor to the family. And in particular, many of you are accomplished, and I respect that. I give honor to our public servants that are here today, and to the other ministers that are here, and those, the clergy. I give honor to you today as a matter of importance, because you are doing important things for us in whatever your call. And so we appreciate that you would come to this service. It's early in the morning on Saturday, but you are here, and we are grateful. We thank you for that. The only way we get this done in a manner that's going to honor Tunde, hopefully I'm not offending anyone if I call him Tunde. That's what he told me to call him. I said, do you want me to call you Emmanuel or Babatunde? He said, no, Tunde. I said, okay, Brother Tunde, you got it. You know, I've learned a long time ago to whatever people want you to call them, that's what you call them. If they say doctor so-and-so, then call them that. If they say this so-and-so, then, you know, whatever they want you to call them, do that. Because why offend? They're asking you to call them by this name. And so for Tunde, we're just going to proceed forward and have this celebration of life. Now, we're apostolic Pentecostal. We don't apologize for that. So if you hear someone in our worship or something, if you hear them speaking in tongues, let me just tell you, Tunde spoke in tongues. And it wasn't Nigerian. It wasn't the language he was taught. He would get right up to that altar. If the word of God hit him, he would get to that altar and he would get it done so he could be right with God. So we're not going to apologize for being that. That's who we are, and we'll let you be who you are, but we're going to go ahead and have church in here today, if that's okay. Hallelujah. I only know one way to do it. That's to give him honor. Give him glory. And if someone else was in there and Tunde was in the audience, let me tell you what he would be doing. The same thing. He would be raising his hands and waving them while he respected your beliefs. Hallelujah. So we're going to proceed onward with an Old Testament scripture. So, oh, come on, Brother Ruff. And by the way, if your name is on the list here, just kind of follow up, and whoever's next, just come sit down over here, and then we'll just keep this flow going so that we don't lose time.
Praise the Lord. My Old Testament scripture will be coming from the book of Psalms, chapter 91. And I'll be reading verses 1 and 2. Amen.
Amen.
He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress, my God, in Him will I trust. And may God bless the reading of the word.
Praise the Lord, everyone. Welcome. I'm going to read scripture from John 14. And the scripture reads, "Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. And if it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also."
At this time, do we have a representative from, where's my guy? Wave at me, wherever you are, that gave me this card. Oh, okay. Do we have a representative from the mayor's office that would like to speak at this time? And then after that, we will have Omawale Walker. If you would just come right on up to the platform, it'd be fine.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Alfred Lance, and I'm from the Mayor's Office of Economic Development. And on behalf of the mayor of the city of Wilmington, Mayor Dennis P. Williams, and our director, Jeff Flynn, who's out of town, we want to extend our condolences to the family. Tunde was a friend and a colleague, years of service dedicated to the city of Wilmington. We are still in shock and don't quite yet have a grasp for the loss that we're experiencing. Tunde celebrated the purchase of my first home. He came to my housewarming party and enjoyed. As we know, Tunde loved a good party. He loved to eat. And we miss his laugh that would fill the office. He is deeply missed, and we share in your sorrow. And may your hearts find comfort in the coming months and in your memories of him.
Good morning. I am Chief Omowale Walker, Vice President of Central Cities of Wilmington, Durosomo, Osun State, Nigeria, West Africa. I am Double Chief of the Maha Temple and founder of Wilmington Friends of Africa. To the family of Dr. Emmanuel Tunde Durosomo. From those organizations I mentioned, and on behalf of my wife, Chief Mrs. Ayodele Walker, and myself, I give you my condolences for your great loss. But we are here today to celebrate the life of Tunde Durosomo. We are in this church to celebrate his life, to remember him and all his good deeds that have been mentioned. I know that there are many more. My celebration, my first celebration with Tunde, was in the church as well. We were celebrating the affiliation of Osogbo to Wilmington. Those of you who are here from the Osogbo Progressive Union, from sister cities of Wilmington, from the Maya Temple, from Friends of Africa, we were all celebrating that great affiliation. Tunde, representing the mayor's office, worked hard, put a lot of energy in that relationship. I have been working with him for over 16 years, keeping that great relationship going. One of our great accomplishments, with the help of our president, Dennis Shearer, was to be able to secure a grant from Sister Cities International, where we're able to build 29 wells in Osogbo, the 7th district of Osogbo, providing reliable water to those districts. I give great credit to Tunde for organizing a historical, cultural, rural visit of the entirety of Osogbo. And the highlight of that visit was a great reception that we had at the Baby Grand Pierre in Wilmington. And his entourage and everyone from, not everyone, but people from the mayor's office, Wilmington Cities. It was great. It was great to be there. Tunde is instrumental in not only the work with Osogbo, but with all of our sister cities. His great energy, economics, culture, educational exchanges with all of our cities, with all of our sister cities, will truly be missed. Mr. Good work for us in the city of Wilmington. He brought about culture. He was proud of his home, the Osogbo Land. I remember we went there with the delegation from Wilmington, and I had to tell Tunde that you've been gone too long. Because when I seen him jump up on the table because he saw something going on the floor, I said, you better be very careful. And those are good times that I will miss with Tunde. The parties have been gone through together. The ones that come to my home, celebrate. He always had a laugh. Big smile. Always had a good heart about him to greet people, to be happy to slap your hand, to say hello, to say thank you. You will all miss that great and that warm personality and all that he has done for each and every one of us. Let us all remember him in our hearts. Smile when we think about his contribution to our life and what he means to each and every one of us. I thank you for your time.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. I like that. Amen. Glory, hallelujah. Sister Claudinia Lowe.
Good morning. Thank you, Jesus. God is so awesome. I got a chance to meet Babatunde, is what I first called him, and he told me to call him that. And then the second time, I called him Tunde. But the third time was special. He told me to call him Boss. He said, I'm your boss. I said, oh, no. He said, I'm the true sergeant, Sister D, around here. Because, you know, they gave me this little nickname, Sergeant. So when he found that out, he says, on Wednesday nights, when you clean, remember who I am. I'm your boss. So as we were clean and we would have fun, Sister Peggy, Sister Tawana, myself, and DZ, he made sure we got every crumb up. Because he would go behind me. He says, Sister, you're not doing a good job here. I said, I'm trying. You know, he says, I'm going to fire you. I said, okay. I said, please give me another chance. But he was so awesome. One day, this was a couple years ago, I got a chance to meet him because I'm the one that introduced him to our church. I was walking into on Market Street Mall in town, and I was just feeling a heavy burden. Our pastor's been, you know, trying to motivate us to reach for the lost. And because that's something we're supposed to do, reach for the lost and souls that are hungry. And when I met him on Market Street Mall, I gave him a card and I invited him to our church. And I said, you know, God has something special for you. And he says, really? I said, yeah. I said, God has something special for you. And he says, you know what? I'm going to come. He says, I'm going to come. He says, I'm not going to come this Sunday, but I will come next Sunday. He made that promise, and when I looked up, he came. And ever since then, he's been a blessing to our church. He's been a true blessing. Let's give him a hand clap. He's been a true blessing. Thank you, Jesus. I'm going to read some cards, and forgive me if I mispronounce your name. But also, I know there's most people wanted to, the ones that did pretty much gave cards. We don't want to read a select few for the sake of time. But I just wanted to say, and I know as well as the family, you know, God is so awesome. He is so awesome. And I'm so glad that you guys gave us a chance to have a relationship. And he's our family. You know, he was, like I said, he was my boss. But he was our family as well. So thank you for that. Thank you, Jesus. To the family of Babatunde, thinking of you with simplicity, just thinking of you, from Valerie Tillman and family. In times of tears, remember the laughter. In times of sadness, remember the smiles. In times of loneliness, remember all ye shared. Hope it helps you to know you have those warm and loving memories forever. My deepest condolence, Babatunde was a co-worker and a friend. He will be deeply missed. Norman Griffiths. In this time of sadness, may you see God in the faces of friends, hear him in their voices, feel him in the touch of their hands. May their help, caring, and sympathy reflect his love and kindness at this time when you need him the most, with caring thoughts and regards from Desmond Baker and family. As you remember, at this time of sorrow, may you find comfort in your memories. He was a dear friend of the board of Sister Cities of Wilmington. Thank you very much. That would be the end of the card reading, but I wanted to say thank you. Thank you. We're going to miss him, but I'm going to be honest with you. What an awesome man. What an awesome man. Thank you very much.
Good morning. Praise the Lord, everybody. God is worthy and worthy to be praised, and we thank him today. I bring you greetings from the Delaware State Senate, where I represent State Senator Margaret Rose Henry, Majority Whip of the 2nd District. We have a tribute here, but before I read this tribute, I want to just to express my condolences to this beautiful family, to whom I know affectionately as Tunde. I met Tunde in 1994 when he came to work for the city of Wilmington under the administration of the former James Sills, Jr. My encounters with Tunde were incredible. They were informative, enlightening, and just the highlight of a happy-go-lucky gentleman. Always a gentleman. Always something nice to say. Always something good to say. Always something funny to say. To us, to me, he was a teaser, and he was a jokester to us. But we loved him in the city of Wilmington, and as I have just graduated from 40 years of employment with the city of Wilmington. The week before I retired, or the week I retired, I had the opportunity to sit and talk with Tunde. And it was such a bittersweet situation, because when you work with someone so kind and sweet, they come become a part of your life. And Tunde was a part of my work life. He was my work buddy. Had I known that at that time when I said goodbye, that I would be saying goodbye for the very last time. When I realized and heard the news that he had gone on to be with the Lord, I believe that. I believe that. He lived his life in such a way, from where I could see, that he was a good man. And when you do good and you live good and you try to do what's right, I believe that God honors that. And I want your family to be comforted to know that God does all things well. He never makes a mistake. What we don't understand, as we say, we'll understand it better by and by. And so now from the State of Delaware Senate in memory, be it known here to all Senate, to all, Senator Margaret Rose Henry is joined by the State Senate of the 148th General Assembly in paying tribute to the life and honor to the memory of Emmanuel Babatunde Durosomo, a native of Lagos, Nigeria, a fine gentleman of many talents. He was well known and held in high regard through his association with the city of Wilmington, where he held several leadership positions, and most especially as a loving father and grandfather. He touched and enriched many numerous lives along his way. His absence will surely be sorely felt by all who knew and loved and admired him. May unto him be granted rest eternal, and may perpetual light shine upon him. With condolences to his children, Tiara, and I need Kalichi to, Dr. Kalichi, if he's in the room, to help me with these names, but it's, I think you all know who you are. Oh boy. To the family and their families as they gather with friends and relations in the SMT Hall and again in Newark United Pentecostal Church. In remembrance, in the thanksgiving of a beloved life well lived, the Senate directs this memorial presented Friday, the 1st of April, Anno Domini 2016. And we pay tribute in love in the spirit of Emmanuel Babatunde Durosomo. All I knew was Tunde.
Hey, where are you? I'm looking for you.
Oh, come on.
I lost you just that quick. Amen. We're having a few additions in the acknowledgments / remarks category. I hope that's okay. We have time. I'll shorten the sermon. How about that? Is that okay? Where's my frat brother? We will finish on time, okay? I promise you.
Thank you so much. I'm here representing City Council. I'm City Councilwoman Maria Cabrera. And on behalf of all of the City Council members, we do have a resolution for Brother Tunde. Now, I had a personal relationship with Tunde. That was my buddy. That was my friend. That was my sidekick. Tunde would come to any event that I was organizing. I also met him when I began working with Mayor James Sills in the Mayor's Office of Cultural Affairs. He was always very supportive of our events. He would come out, he would participate, he would volunteer, and of course he was always around for the after party, so we always enjoy those moments. As my career moved on, I did events at the Grand Opera House. He would come to those, and as I was the president of the Hispanic Business Association, he especially loved to join and to be with people of different cultures, coming from such rich a culture. And the favorite moments for Tunde was when he would come to this beautiful garden that I built in my backyard. And it was sometimes it would be very spontaneous. He would come over, he would always enjoy a good wine, and he knew that I was a wine snob, so we would always have some good wine in the garden. So these are the moments we spent, and I will say that my last moments with Tunde was at the Christmas party last year, We were all having a good time, him and my coworker Tracy from the council office. We said, well, where are we going after the mayor's party? So we found a couple spots to hit that night. Needless to say, it was the wee hours of the morning, but we've always enjoyed the time together. And as was mentioned here today, he had an infectious laugh. When he laughed, it just the whole room would be filled, and you just felt that joy. And you know, Tunde always had a kind word to say about anyone. I've never heard him say anything negative. And last but not least, with my other job as an affordable healthcare navigator, Tunde, he was one of our partners because we formed the community advisory board. So Tunde, and through his church and the pastor, he helped us to reach the uninsured in Delaware and to help us enroll them. So there's so many things that he did that probably people didn't even know, because he wasn't one to take credit. He was just one to do. So of course, you know, my heart goes out to the family, to the community, because we really miss, we lost a brother, but we're celebrating his life here today. And Tunde's looking down and saying, please, people, have a good glass of wine and remember me and celebrate. The resolution reads, whereas council wishes to offer its deepest sympathy and prayers to the family of our friend and City of Wilmington official, Dr. Emmanuel Babatunde Durosomo, who departed this life on February 4th, 2016. And whereas beloved firstborn son of Elijah and Victoria Durosomo, Dr. Tundo Durosomo, was born on May 26, 1953 in Lagos, Nigeria. He received his early education in Oshogo, Nigeria, and attended the prestigious Oshogo Grammar School, where he graduated with distinction in 1969. And whereas, determined to continue his education, Dr. Durosomo proceeded to the United States of America in 1971 and enrolled in Hampton University, where he obtained a Bachelor of Science degree in chemistry. He further pursued his graduate studies by attending the Marshall University in Huntington, Virginia, and received his Master's of Business Administration. He applied this knowledge by working as a polymer chemist in the United States and later in his native Nigeria. And whereas Dr. Durosomo's persistence, thirst for knowledge, and would ultimately initiate his return to the United States, which allowed him to take part in the PhD program, he studied and obtained his PhD degree in international relations from the University of Delaware. And whereas it was upon the completion of this doctorate that Dr. Durosomo would begin his illustrious career with the City of Wilmington. Employed with the city since 1994, he held numerous leadership positions within local government, including Director of International Development and Senior Economic Advisor to the Mayor, the position he occupied until his death. Whereas, during his tenure with the City of Wilmington, Dr. Durosomo advocated for the establishment of various sister cities, including that of his native hometown of Oshogo, Nigeria. He was proud of this affiliation, as the Oshogo and the City of Wilmington sister city connection has benefited and contributed to the development of both cities immensely. And whereas, known for his passion to improve his local community here and abroad, Dr. Durosomo was an active member of its community and belonged to various organizations such as Sister Cities of Wilmington International, Oshogo Progressive Union, USA Charter, the Delaware African Collision Group, and numerous others. Whereas he maintained a strong tie with his indigenous Oshun state in Nigeria, he endeavored to bring development to the state, a passion that got him involved in politics of the state. This desire led him to contest for the governorship of the state in 2003, an undertaking that cost him a lot of personal fortune. His passion and determination to connect with his homeland, to share his wealth and experience to benefit the masses far exceed any personal loss that he suffered. Whereas Dr. Durosomo's legacy lives on through his children and grandchildren, he is survived by his children, Tira Durosomo, Omolola Durosomo, Omatunde Durosomo, Babajide Durosomo, and Omolara Durosomo, grandchildren Anye Hall and Ayana Holt, Nashim Outlaw, Elijah Gibbons, and Sierra Hamilton. What a big family, what a beautiful family. Now, therefore, be it resolved by the Council of the City of Wilmington that Wilmington City Council joins and salutes the life and memory of Dr. Emmanuel Babatunde Durosomo and extends his heartfelt sympathies to his loving families, members, and friends. Thank you so much. I just want to mention that Councilwoman Sherry Dorsey was here earlier, and of course, Justin, oh, she's right here, and Councilman Justin Wright, who is taking care of the services today for you. Thank you.
Well, praise the Lord. How are we doing? We doing okay?
Good morning, everyone. My name is Karen Burton, and Tunde was known to me as Baba. He called me his big bro, and I mean, he was my big bro, and he called me his baby sister. 1 million. I calculated that out, right? 1 million minutes Tunde has infected my life. I worked in the city of Wilmington for almost 15 years in the mayor's office of economic development. Tunde and I worked together during my tenure there. And let me tell you, I'm back in that pew crying my eyes out. And I just felt my big bro saying, girl, if you don't wipe your tears and get up there and say something about me. Let me tell you, I'm gonna tell you a little bit of story about what we would do in the Office of Economic Development. We were fortunate enough to have some wonderful leaders in that department. Dick Pryor and Joe DePinto, who's sitting in the back right there. And I'm gonna tell you that our office and our colleagues together, we just had a great unity. We were just a little small family because it was only about 8 of us working in that department, but we really worked hard for the city and represented. Tunde, every time I would have to order lunch for something, we all know Tunde loved to eat, right? So one of the colleagues, Niece Davis, that would always say, Karen, let us get our food first before you tell Tunde we have leftovers. So I'm telling everybody, it's food in the kitchen, it's food in the kitchen, it's food in the kitchen, right? Here come Baba walking down the hall. Then he give me this look, baby sister, why did you not tell me first, I'm your brother, that there's food left over? I said, Tunde, because if I tell you, it would be nothing left over for the rest of the team to eat. There was time when Carolyn Martin, she used to be the director of constituent services, and she would come over and her team would tell us, oh, there was food left over. We was like, okay, we let everybody else know, we tell Tunde last. The real estate and housing department, during the Christmas time, all different departments would have like little holiday celebrations and luncheons. Everybody in the building knew. If your department was having some kind of food, that you don't let Tunde know until last. But if Tunde got a hint that you were having and you didn't tell him, he has something to say. I was on the phone talking to Val a lot. We were on the phone talking, I'm reminiscing. I said, girl, let me tell you about Tunde, the stuff he would do to me. I had left some lunch in the office. And I knew that the next day, I was gonna have this wonderful meal. I mean, my mouth, I was just like, I can't wait to have my lunch. I can't wait because I left it over. I went in, opened up the fridge, and looked, and it was gone. Somebody done took my lunch. Oh, my God. I know that cleaning staff did not take my lunch, right? So I'm going to every office, polling everyone. By the way, did you do that? No. I get to Tunde's office. Bob, you are not going to believe this. He's at his computer typing, and he looked up. What's that? Is going. What lunch? I said that was in the refrigerator. Was it in the bag? I said, yeah. Was it the glass container with the green top on it? I said, yeah. I ate it.
You what?
I ate it.
Then why didn't you eat my lunch?
Because you left it there for me.
Tunde, I'm so pissed off at you right now.
He's like, well, that's what brothers do to baby sisters. Man, we had some laughs in there. We had a colleague named Lenine, and she played a joke on everybody in the office. She had these scratch-offs, and it made you think that you actually won some money down at the lottery. So we had one colleague, Denise Davis, and Joe DePinto was in on this joke. Denise Davis, she had scratched hers off. Well, that child called down to the department for the tickets and stuff to make sure that it was okay. So Joe and I were all in on it, and we were like, well, do you need an escort down to Dover so you can get your money? I mean, it was just so funny. Well, we did the same thing with Tunde, and it was Lenine and I. And we gave him the scratch off, and my area was right across from the kitchen area. So Tunde goes in the kitchen, and he starts scratching it off. And I'm watching him, and he's scratching it off. And then all of a sudden, he stops like this. And then I saw him doing this dance. Tunde thought he had won $1 million. And Lenine and I were dying. We laughed so hard. Val, I had that video on my own phone, and I looked at it and laughed every time because that's what kept me up. He was jumping up and down, baby, sis, I want some money, I want some money, I want some money, I want some money. But the best thing about Tunde that I loved about him was on Wednesdays, we'd hit our power. We hit hour of power on Wednesday. We made it a point down there, either down at Bethel or Ezion, had hour of power. Every Wednesday, 12 o'clock, Tunde, a lot of the other city workers, we make it. Me and Tunde walking in the cold down our power. I can't tell you, look, it would be so much stuff going on in the building that we were like, we got to go in here and pray for our colleagues. We got to pray for leadership. We got to pray for this. We go down, and we go down to our power on Wednesday. We made it a point. Sometimes we miss it, but we said we would schedule it into our calendars. I told you all Tunde likes to eat, right? We all know that. We get the word. The altar call comes. If I'm having an issue, I could feel him behind me praying, and I knew the stuff that was going on with Tunde, and I would stand behind him when we would hit that altar call. And then when at lunchtime, after hour of power, you know, they always feed you and they give you this brown bag. My bro, we're leaving out, and if I did not grab my lunch in the brown bag, because I always pack my lunch, he'd be like, why didn't you get lunch from me? I said, Tunde, they giving it away. He said, put the money in to get a bag for me. So my brother, for every brown bag of lunch that we would get after hour of power, and Tunde would be so happy fixing it all up and eating it. But what was so great was that the word and the message was so clear every week. And the worship that Tunde and I would come into the mayor's office of economic development with song in the hearts and a word. And if any of our members or colleagues missed that word, we'd share it. Then we started a little prayer warriors group that people didn't know about, with the director now in the real estate and housing, I can't remember her name right now, and Dorian Snyder in the fire marshal's office, because it was just so much just wrong stuff going on, and we knew it, and we'd pray. And that's my bro, my big bro that looked after me, and I'm glad, and I'm honored that he called me his baby sister, and I'm honored that I knew Tunde, who sat with royalty, kings and queens, and people didn't know that about him. People didn't even know how he was just so anointed, because Tunde was sick, and they saw cancer in his body, and he said, baby sis, God's gonna heal me, and my life is changing, because he healed me. And he went back to the doctors, and they didn't see cancer in his body anymore. So I know what God can do, and I thank him for allowing, and I thank his family for allowing us to have Tunde in our lives.
Amen. We have yet another person that wants to say something.
May the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. My name is Daphne Santosa. My husband was from Indonesia. And dear family, I know what you're going through. It's going to be with you, the love, the caring. My husband passed on in 2004. You will always miss him. Today, I ask permission to give tribute to, we knew him as Tunde Durosomo. I got to know him through the office of the mayor of the city of Wilmington. We had a habit of inviting the mayor to our Guyanese Association and Friends picnic every year. Mayor James Baker had a very efficient appointment secretary. Promptly, she would respond and say the mayor could not attend, and she it was who suggested that Tunde Durosomo could represent the mayor. He came to our picnic in Banning Park, and Tunde took things to a higher level. He took the third beatitude in the Gospel of St. Matthew very seriously. Blessed are the meek. We found Tunde to be affable and meek. Always. We knew it was not a pretense. Always. He attended our picnic many years. And in 2013, when our ambassador from Guyana, representing Guyana in Washington, D.C., came to our picnic, we were pleased to present Tunde as representing the mayor of Wilmington. It was a Pentecostal day. They were all with one accord in one place, harmonious. I said only 2 minutes, and I'll keep it there, sir. But I want you to know that my church brought in somebody from Africa to one of our meetings. And I was serving as librarian at the Kumba Academy at the time. We had a book fair, and Tunde was invited by me to declare open the book fair. It was my pleasure that this farmer from Kenya had an opportunity to see a brother African in a responsible position in the city of the first state of this nation. My grief is with you, my joy is with you, and as I go, I'm going to say farewell in a rural Guyanese way. In the rural Guyana, we'll say, bye Tunde, I will go miss you. But we know that you have blow good breeze, Panawi. Thank you for your life. Bye-bye.
Glory, hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Don't fear, little flock. When you have a dignitary pass on as this, and people are compelled to say something about that individual, it is a compliment and an honor to the family. So where you might not see those names on our program for today, it's okay, because their complete and total intent is to honor Emmanuel Babatunde Durosomo. Glory, hallelujah. Glory, hallelujah. Glory, hallelujah. Glory, hallelujah. I know what it's like now to be compelled to let me speak. Hallelujah. What a guy. But now we have Tunde's son is going to come. Where is Lo? You got out of it. You I should probably put you on there anyway. Come, young man, speak.
Praise the Lord. Amen. Praise the Lord. My dad was amazing. I didn't know that. And he came to this world with a purpose, and he achieved that purpose. It's unfortunate, you know, he was taken away, but God's plans are always the best. And I just want to thank everyone for coming today. You know, it's not easy waking up, coming for this type of get together. You know, it's really touching, and just seeing everyone here today just shows me how much my dad did. My dad was a typical African man. You know, he was tough. It was tough, you know. I know when I graduated from University of Maryland, Baltimore County, I was excited. I'm like, oh, what am I gonna get for my graduation present? You know, some of my friends were getting cars. You know, it was like, yeah. And he came, and he gave me $100. I was like, wow. I didn't understand that. I was like, why would you do this? I went through the struggle, you know, graduating, you're proud of me and everything, and all I get is this. But looking at it right now, the message was trying to communicate to me was, you fight for what you want in life. And one thing I know about my dad was that he fought for everything. He wasn't a chill person. As I said yesterday, he did everything hard. He didn't have any middle ground for anything. Once he's passionate about something, he went hard. He partied hard. He loved hard. You know, he did everything with a passion. And just hearing what everyone has to say about him today, just, I didn't know all this. And that's actually what hurts me. Because he did so much. He sacrificed so much. And that $100 he gave me, now I understand the value, because he went to Oshobo to do so much. You know, his own personal finances, that's what he did to try and run for governorship for Osun State. And, you know, like, I was like, why are you doing this? The money you should be spending on your family, you know, going into politics, but, you know, he was born to serve. And that, like, I truly, truly understand right now. Life is short, people. Life is short. You know, we come here, we try to acquire stuff, we try to get things and all that. But one thing my dad did was, for you to make an impact in this world, you have to better yourself. You have to have a platform on which you can stand on and people can hear you. And that's what my dad did through, like, his education. I was like, man, PhD, I'm like, cool. Yeah. But now I understand why he did that, because if he didn't have that platform in today's society, he wouldn't have a voice. You know, and he had a voice, he had a mission, and he had a plan. And I'm glad to say he fulfilled the plan. Another thing I just want to say is, you know, like, our choices matter a lot in life. They matter. When you're thinking about deciding on what to do, make sure it benefits everyone around you. That's it. Don't think about yourself. And that was my dad. He didn't think about himself. As long as everyone was okay, it was fine. It was fine. And even when he had this, 1980 Mercedes Benz. Get a new car, like you can't. I was like, this is so old, you know, but you know, he was using the funds for other things to better other people's lives. You know? And I just want to encourage everyone today, you know, this world will always remain. We are passengers, we come and go. But we have to leave something behind. He left the beautiful people you see in front of me right here. And he left something in each of your hearts. I'm celebrating his life, you know, like, throughout this whole, like, experience, I didn't cry. I was like, I have to stay strong. But when I got here this morning and I saw this, it hit me hard. But it's a celebration. So please, people, you know, just celebrate my dad. He left a legacy, a good legacy of service. And that's the one thing I'm going to take from this. I'm, you know, it's... His laugh. And you know, like, I remember when we had like the first time I came over to Delaware, and you know, I met my sisters and we all got together and he started laughing. We all just looked at each other and we were like, yep, you know, he's doing a game. He did so much. I didn't even know his position, you know. I was like, oh, okay, yeah, you know. But, you know, he had this, you know, he portrayed to us that, you know, he had this hard shell. You know, he was this strong, but he was so soft. And I know where I get my caring heart, because, you know, it's definitely from him. And you know, like, I'm proud. I'm really, really proud to be a Durosomo. I'm proud to be his son. And you know, just to wrap this up, I just want to say thank you so much again for coming. I know people came from all over. You know, people from Maryland, people from Texas, people from Cali, people from everywhere, Nigeria, United Kingdom. I just want to thank you so much. You guys have blessed the family. You know, like, I didn't know, this turnout is amazing, it's amazing. I know I have huge shoes to fill, you know, but, you know, in this imperfect world of ours, he tried to make it perfect for others. Praise the Lord again.
Glory, hallelujah. Glory. Love God, love people. That's a formula. Love God, love people. Love God, love people. Love God. See, I'm feeling my preach coming on. Hallelujah. Come on.
Hello, everyone. I tried to get out of it, but I guess it wouldn't let me. But anyway, thank you all for all your support and all of your prayers, because without any of you, this would have been very difficult I especially want to thank my Uncle Victor for hanging in there with us. You know, it was very hard, very time consuming. You know, a lot of us were drained because of the fact that, you know, it was a waiting period, but this time has finally come. Now that this time is here, I could feel the sense of closure, because now that my dad can finally be put to rest. As a child, I grew up, I'm his oldest daughter. And as a child, I grew up and saw my dad evolve. I seen him start from the bottom to the top. He started doing construction work and all of that stuff. He was a security officer. Never did I ever think my dad would excel to have his PhD. And to see him excel like that, that showed us that we can do it as well. And he let us know that everything is possible. No matter what you go through in life, there's always a way. God will always make a way. In the beginning, my dad wasn't really all that close to God, but I saw what God can do. Me and my mom and my sisters, like, my mother always kept us in church. Way back in the past, in my dad's younger days, he hardly went to church. But because of my mother's prayers, she never gave up on him. And then eventually God took control of my dad, and I'm thankful because I know right now he's in heaven next to God. I stayed strong. Every time I would get ready to cry, I'll hear that laugh. Or he'll say, Lola, don't do it. Or something funny would come up, and I would hear my dad's laugh. Immediately, I would stop crying, because I knew he wouldn't want to see me cry. When I was a kid, I'd fall down and hurt myself. It wasn't like, oh, come here. It's okay. No, it was like, get up. Come on. I'm looking at him like, Dad, why ain't you pat me on the back? You know, fixing me all up, trying to... You know, you get up and you keep on going. And that's what I have in my heart now as a grown woman. I'm now 39 years old, and I have that strength in me that he put in me to keep on going no matter what goes on, to keep on pushing, don't ever give up. And no one could ask for a better gift from a better dad, and I thank God that he blessed me with him to be my dad. And I cannot wait. I don't want to go no time soon, because I got kids, my kids as well. But I cannot wait, Dad, till I see you again. Yes. I love you.
Glory, hallelujah. Every now and then when the preacher's in touch with God, he can get some things right. How could she not speak? Now, see, I'm starting to really feel comfortable. Victor, come on up here. I'm starting to feel like I'm at church now. Must be the Holy Ghost.
Thank you, Pastor. Praise the Lord. Thank you, everybody, again for coming. I didn't know I was going to be up here again. I mean, up here this morning. Like yesterday, I said what I had to say about my brother. Like I told everybody last night, he was much older than me. And where we come from was almost like a father. And before I grew up enough to know, enough to say anything, he was already heart of the house. And he went to the United States. So we didn't really grow up together, you know, in very close quarters. Our relationship most of the time was always long distance. He even came back to Nigeria And 2 years after I came back to Nigeria, I came to the United States. And we always lived in different states. And but we had to cultivate most of our relationship in short visits and over the telephone. And I was always amazed at the amount of time that he gave when we spoke. He would speak for 2 hours at a time. And also all these organizations that he was involved with, the amount of time he had for it. And then also the time he had for his family. And it amazes me. I don't know if I could do that much, you know, with the time. Because he was a community man. He was the man for everybody. And he had it, it was his passion, like Gide said, to help people. And that led him to Nigeria, back to Nigeria to contest for the governorship. And I personally know how much that cost him. I tried to discourage him, but he couldn't be discouraged. I said, look, you know, this, but because of the passion he had to help people, he just had to do it. And that cost him a lot, not just finances, but I knew in time, because if he had invested the same time here, I knew what he would have done, what he would have achieved with the same time. If he had invested the same resources and everything. But because of his heart to help people, because of his heart to just make sure that everything around him, everybody, you know, whatever he could do to lift people, he wanted to do. And very, very grateful for that. And I will always remember him. Like I told people who came to last night's service, he told me, maybe it was one sentence, when I was coming to the United States from Nigeria, he was there back then, and I was fortunate to have gotten a scholarship to come and study here. So he called me to the room. He said, you know, you are so fortunate you got this scholarship. He said, when I was going in 1971, I didn't have a scholarship, and our father didn't have much money to give to me. But he said something to me that, look, son, you are going, I don't have much to give you, but I've given you a good name. So don't bastardize that name. He said, so, you know, at that time, our father had passed away. So he said, well, you know, I'm going to give you the same advice. They gave me a good name. I took it there. I didn't do anything bad with it. You two, you go. Personally, he said, I couldn't give you much money, but the family has given you a good name. Do not bastardize it. And so that name, you know, resonated in my heart throughout. You know, it was like a name, something to guide me against, you know, doing bad things, against cutting corners when things were hard, against compromising something that could get me in trouble, especially with the law. So that stayed with me. And it was a very fatherly statement to me, and I kept it. And I remember a lot of the wisdom that he gave me over the time. And I'm going to miss that, but I loved him for it. And we're celebrating his life, and we'll always remember that. And I thank everybody again, from the mayor's office, to the sister cities, to the... it was when he passed away that I got to know all his involvement. I didn't even know he was involved in peace initiative with Pakistan. You know, he went to Pakistan because when he told me about it, it was for he said we had to understand these people better. So when they went there, they realized that the people, not the government, not the politicians, were actually the peace-loving people. So you hear different things about Pakistan in the news. Those are not the people. That was the people making the decision, the politicians. So he was involved with that. I didn't know until later time. And we have the sister cities. It was a very great achievement for Oshogbo, where we are from. That was very, very great initiative and great accomplishment. And they've done a lot of good things for the city. We have all these bodies that they went to school together. They call them Oshogbo Grammar School Old Boys Association. They were there yesterday, and one of his senior was gave it to us. It was very funny, and a pastor too, who prayed a blessing on us yesterday. We had the Oshogbo Progressive Union formed to look after the welfare for Oshogbo, and they are always about the development. I thank you all for your support, and from the state, from the Senate, I thank you very much. And now I saw my brother's little sister who came up here. I had not met her before. She had called me when everything happened, and she was just telling me everything, something I didn't even know about my brother. So I thank you all very much for coming, and God will bless you in his infinite mercies. I pray that I will always come to celebrate good and great things with you, and the family is very grateful. And thank you, Pastor.
Amen. Miss Valerie, are you ready? Amen. She's going to come sing a solo. Can you worship with us? We're not entertainers. So your worship with us is important. You would just go with us to where we're trying to go. Help us get there. Help us sing a song of praise, of worship, of glad tidings. Just help us. Amen.
Giving honor to God. Lord, we love you. Lord, we praise you. Thank you, Lord, for the life that I've lived with Tunde. Very rewarding. I want to sing this song because I know that Tunde would be saying this if he could. If you want to know where I'm going, if you want to know, because I'm going up yonder, going up yonder, I'm going up yonder to be with my Lord. Oh, I'm going up yonder, going up yonder. I'm going up yonder. Rejoice with me to be with my Anybody at you? Come on, come on. You know it, sing it. Where I'm going. Where I'm going soon. I can take the pain, the heartache it brings. I got confidence in knowing. Oh.
Give God the praise.
Come on, let's praise him. Hallelujah. Come on, church members. Let's worship. Itinerary modifications. Actually, the obituary has been read. You may be seated, if you can. If you can't, you go ahead and stand up and do what you need to do. So we will forego the reading of the obituary. Our councilwoman, well, she pronounced those names so well. Amen. Hallelujah. You have to develop skills like that to be a councilwoman. Amen. For the worship team, you're going to play during the recessional as we go out. I'll call you when it's time for that. For our sound room video person, it's time to cue up the message. Hallelujah. I don't know about you, but I feel the Holy Ghost. I hope you can feel the presence of God here. There is a God. There is a God. And he's just not off in heaven, tooling around, kicking up in a lazy boy, watching us go through what we go through. Not this God. This one is engaged in the activities of life. In everything that he points to us is about living. See, God is a God of life, not death. Consider this point. The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. What that means is when God created Adam and Eve, he did not create them to die. You were not created to die. You were made in the image of God. And in God's image, being that God is a spirit, according to John 4:24, he's a spirit, and you and I can't see a spirit. So the part of us that is made in the image of God, you can't see. It's spiritual. Oh, man. I'm searching for an amen corner somewhere. So I don't always need help, but every now and then, if I say something that is really like it was a revelation to me, I'm thinking it's going to be a revelation to somebody else. That's why I say it. So I might need somebody to, if you get a revelation, just to go ahead on and beller it out. Amen. So since we were not created to die, see, in the infinite wisdom of God, what he does is he says, all souls are mine. Yeah. You see? And see, when we die, the part of us that's made in the image of God goes back to God. Yes. That's Bible, by the way. So guess what? There's a path we can follow that guarantees the destination. Hallelujah. And this guy, it's already been said that he's special. But you don't know how special till you get to see him in the dark times. See, Tunde had some dark moments. Even in his later years, he had some dark moments, but he still had this inner tenacity to not lose focus on what was important. That's why all of you are full of accolades about this individual. Because even in his down moments, you were able to see brightness. You were able to see and perceive that he was the same when he was down as when he was up. See, that's internal. By the way, that's in your DNA. You said it. It's in your DNA. More than what you said is in your DNA. I want to read Psalms chapter 116 to you. I want to show you something. I promise you I won't wear you out. It's 19 verses. I want to read all 19. But I want to point to two of them in particular. It won't wear you out. It's good to read scripture. You go to church, you ought to read the Bible.
You know, in fact, if you go to church, it's healthy to bring a Bible. Even though modern technology allows us to have it on our cell phone and have it projected with nice video presentation and all of that, it's still good just to carry one, just to have it. Yeah. We spend money on a lot of things. Go get yourself a good Bible. The paper. See, I've crossed 60, so, man, I still like paper. And somebody in their 20s, they said, well, I got the Bible right here. Got you. You can't highlight like I can. You can't make little side footnotes. Yes, I can. Well, let me see. Psalms chapter 116. The scripture says, I love the Lord because he hath heard my voice and my supplications. Because he hath inclined his ear unto me, therefore will I call upon him as long as I live. Stop there, back up, stop there. Two, because he hath, see, how do you know when God is listening? See, if you know that God is listening, that second part ought to be something else that becomes a part of you. Therefore, will I call, since he's listening, let me tell him a few things. If he's giving me audience, let me say what I need to say. You got it. Three. The sorrows of death compassed me, and the pains of hell got hold upon me. I found trouble and sorrow. Then called I upon the name of the Lord. O Lord, I beseech thee, deliver my soul, since you're listening. Gracious is the Lord and righteous, yea, our God is merciful. The Lord preserveth the simple. I was brought low, and he helped me. Can you just back up to six for 1 second, Deborah? You're right on it, though. Mr. Video, he got it going on. He said, you said you're going to roll it. So, but just hold on a minute. I got to preach a little bit in the middle of there. The Lord preserveth the simple. You don't have to be smart to get God's help. You just have to be. If you could just be, you can get God's help. You don't have to be smart. You can be simple. See, this writer clicked into something. God is listening, so I'm going to talk to him. He says, I don't have to be smart. I don't have to be all up here high and mighty. I don't have to be any of that to get God to listen to me. And so since he's paying attention to the simple, I think I'll just go right ahead on and keep it moving with him. See, the writer has found out something about God, and I'm going to tell you, it's true. I was brought low and he helped me. Verse 7. Return unto thy rest, O my soul, for the Lord hath dealt bountifully with thee. Back up. I can't let. How about if I just give you the. I'll just keep it simple for you. This individual is telling their soul to tamp it down and rest a little bit. He said, the Lord hath dealt bountifully with thee. Let me tell you something about God. See, when you catch on to this, you'll never let it go. Because things happen spiritually first. Then they come true in the natural. So here's an example. Let there be light. And then there was light. See, if you want to get God on your side, then you start talking to him, recognizing that even if you're not smart, he's going to pay attention to you. And if you ask him for help, he's going to help you and deal bountifully with you. But as soon as you say, God, can you please help me? If God moves right away Ask and you shall receive. Seek and you shall find. Knock and it shall be opened unto you. If God moves right away, it happens in the spirit before it happens in the natural. If it doesn't happen, if he doesn't help you in the spirit, you don't get the help in the natural. So we're sitting here thinking, I just asked him, why doesn't he? Well, let him give him time to process the thing and think it through and see how he wants to do it for you. And you're thinking, well, he hasn't moved for me yet. Well, of course not. First, he's got to formulate his plan, and then he's got to go ahead and execute his plan. Then he's got to assign his angels to it, and then they've got to go make it happen for you. Might take a minute. How long did it take you to get into that situation? I'm trying to help somebody. See, this is what caught Tunde's attention. How I do this is I don't, Lord, I only want to say what you want me to say. I don't want to say one word more or one word less. And there are times when I'm getting ready to say something and God will just, and I'll say, oh, okay. And I won't say that. But I know I'm supposed to say this. Eight. For thou hast delivered my soul from death, mine eyes from tears, and my feet from failing. Anybody been rescued here? I mean, this stuff you can't tell people. But God gave you a reprieve. Come on now. Tell the truth and shame the devil. You got away with some things. Not because you were so smart, but because God allowed it. You did something. And before you could, the punishment could come, you was asking God for forgiveness, and he forgave you, and then he gave you a pardon. You didn't even suffer for what you did. I will walk before the Lord in the land of the living. See, this writer... You know how scripture comes about or came about, right? The Bible says God breathed into the writers and they wrote. God breathed. He did that with everybody but Moses. Moses, he spoke to as a man face to face. Everybody else, he breathed into. He breathed his scripture into them. 10. I believe, therefore have I spoken. I was greatly afflicted. I said in my haste, all men are liars. What shall I render unto the Lord for all his benefits toward me? I will take the cup of salvation and call upon the name of the Lord. Stop right there. God wants to save me. That statement is true of me. If you will let it, that statement will be true of you. God wants to save you. You say, well, I want to know the will of God for my life. Well, he wants you to be saved. He didn't create you to be a plaything for the devil. And some of us are good playthings for the devil. Some of us, we say we don't want to be played, but we're being played like a fiddle. No wonder we don't want to be played. We're being played enough. You see. I will take the cup of salvation. In other words, Lord, you are offering me salvation. I'll take that cup. It's not, I don't want that right now, Lord. By the way, that was me at one point in my life. Lord, I don't know, Lord, you go here right now. I got to go do over here. But Lola, somebody was praying for me. Where you at? There you are. Somebody was praying. The prayers of the saints avail much. I will call upon the name of the Lord. Come on, we can go. 14, I'm sorry. Am I wiggling the wrong way? I will pay my vows unto the Lord now in the presence of all his people. In other words, this individual is saying, this process that God has got me on, what you want me to do, Lord? I'll do it in front of everybody. Now, sometimes we don't, you know, one guy walked up to me one time. I went into a store, and the guy walked up to me and said, man, you have a lot of courage. I said, I do? Yeah, I don't know too many people that would have a Jesus license plate on the front of their car. I didn't think that was a big deal, but he did. He didn't have anybody in his circle that would put the name of Jesus on the front of their car. So he thought, man, you're kind of brave. You must be brave to do that. Now, every vehicle I buy, on my desk is taped the names of the Lord. On my desk where I can work and I can look over and see one of them every night. I want to be reminded about God. I put little things in my life so I can remind myself that God is active in my life. You see, I want to be reminded. When I got a promotion at my job, I set up a little place for my Bible. And I opened every day when I went to work, I would open my Bible and turn to a page and I would read. And sometimes, you know how you read and those scriptures aren't too kind to you. I keep reading until I got a good one. I said, I work with that one today, Lord. I'm not trying to sabotage myself. I'm trying to encourage myself in the Lord. Are you understanding what I'm saying? So now I will pay my vows unto the Lord now in the presence of all his people. Let's go to, yeah, there we go. Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints. O Lord, truly I am thy servant. Truly I am thy servant. I am thy servant and the son of thine handmaid. Thou hast loosed my bonds. Next one. I will offer to thee the sacrifice of thanksgiving and will call upon the name of the Lord. I will pay my vows unto the Lord now in the presence of all his people. Last verse. In the courts of the Lord's house, in the midst of thee, O Jerusalem. So we can say, in the midst of thee, and you can substitute your city. Praise ye the Lord. In other words, it's like, watch me serve God. Watch me get my serve on. Watch me do this thing that you might not understand, but I'm going to do this thing, and I'm going to do it this way because I'm connected to the one who's looking out for me. And see, this psalm is so appropriate for the individual whose human remains are housed here, but his spirit has gone back to the Lord who sent it. You see, he came to the church at a time when it looked like everything was okay. Your loved one. See this Babatunde. And the first time he came, he had full African regalia. Wasn't that a New Year's Eve service we did? I'm asking some. And he strutted on in there, that hat high and hooked up here. And I'm like, you know, what do I know? I'm just some simple African-American preacher that's trying to make it to heaven and give instruction to people, whoever will receive it. And if you don't, okay, you know, you get to live. But I'm going to tell you what I think God wants me to tell you. And if it fits, that's good for you. But if it's not, and you decide to go your way, we good. We don't have to create an angst. And he came in and all we did was worship and praise and eat. We did eat afterwards. You know, Pentecostals, you all probably don't know, Pentecostals do eat. They eat a lot. We'll break bread over anything. Oh, you made up a new song? Well, let's get together over lunch. Let's look that thing over. Let's see what you're trying to say. Any opportunity, we'll get it done. Amen. So he fit right in. And we didn't know him as an eater, did we, church? He ate a little bit as far as we're concerned. We're like, you done? Okay, it's good. We'll let you, you know, he didn't eat like he did it, probably because he was full at work. Maybe that's, we're the sister. Maybe that's why he didn't eat. We got it now. He took care of all that at work. Amen. But what matters most? See, when he was first diagnosed with prostate cancer, he said, Pastor, I'm diagnosed with prostate cancer. I said, Tunde, I said, you know what? We'll pray. We'll pray. And I commenced to pray in, the church commenced to pray in, and, you know, in the normal course of apostolic preaching, I don't know if you know this or not, but in the normal course of apostolic preaching, we'll anoint you and pray for you that God will heal you. We do that. We'll slap that on. In the name of Jesus. But we preach that. You know why? Because God heals. And so, Tunde got to believe in the message. And he said, well, Pastor, I'm not going for the treatments. God can heal me. I said, okay. I said, I believe with you, bro. And every, that for like a year, he would go to the altar and we'd be praying and we'd pray for him, we'd pray for us, we'd lay hands on him, he'd lay hands on us, we're praying. We're praying for all kinds of stuff. And then he said, hey, I'm going away for a week, and I'll be back. He wouldn't tell us where he was going. He said, I'm going away for a week. Well, he was going down to Houston. And he went down there, and he didn't tell him anything as far as I know. He just said, look me over to see if I have cancer. And he directed them in the areas, and they couldn't find cancer after 2 days. Yeah, but hold on. And so what happened was, he said, well, I was diagnosed with cancer a year ago at St. Francis Hospital. They said, what doctor? This is his words. I'm repeating to you his words when he returned. And he told him the doctor. They said, well, will you release us to get the information? He said, sure. So he signed off on the documents. They contacted the doctor. They sent 7 samples of biopsies that they had done on Tunde. All of them malignant. All of them cancerous. So they read them and they looked and they said, okay, can you give us just a couple of more days? We want to go back in and look and die and see what we can find. And they took 2 more days of test and found none. And so, see, we're talking about a medically documented miracle. And so then they called him into the office and they said, you know, we know that these are your samples. I guess they did whatever. Are they even his samples? And they did blood and all of whatever they do. And they confirmed that they were his samples taken from his body. And the cancer was present, and then they also said to him, but we can't find any cancer in you. We know where they looked, we know we've got all this stuff, and we're looking there, and we don't see anything. You haven't had any treatment. You don't show any signs of any treatment. He said, no, I haven't had any treatment. And they said, well, we can't find any cancer. He says, well, that means that I'm cancer-free. And he said, well, we can't say that. Make a long story short, he said, you can't find it because God healed me. And I'm going on from here. Now, this was how many years ago, family? Better than 5 or so? Better than 5 years. And he came back, said, Pastor, I have a testimony, but I need the microphone. Anybody know that about Tunde? He liked the mic? Maybe just us know it. gave him the mic, and that Sunday I didn't get to preach because the saints got to rejoicing behind the miracle working hand of God, and he became number two medically documented miracle from our church. He was not the first. I like to tell people it's in our church DNA because we connected. We've had people come to the church with cancer and it no longer be there. They're still in the church, but the cancer had to go. Sometimes people can't receive this kind of talk, but it's true. He believed God, and it happened. He wasn't supposed to live as long as he lived. The devil wanted him gone early, but God had another plan. Are you listening? Are you listening? And I feel the Holy Ghost as much as I ever have. This individual right here came right back. He said, Pastor, I'm going to go into the hospitals now and start praying for people to get healed. He started going into the hospitals. I don't know if y'all knew this about him. He was going to the hospital, teaching Bible studies to the sick and praying for them to be healed. Oh, yes, he was. That was his MO, his modus operandi. There you go. This guy believed God. I'm telling you, I don't know where your faith is in God. But if you understand the scripture, how he's the author and the finisher of our faith, there's no such thing that you don't have enough faith. Jesus never talked to people like, he said, oh, ye of little faith. But there's no such thing as not having enough faith because he's the author of it and he has to finish it off anyway. We never will have perfect faith for healing. If we do, it came from him. That's how we got it. And see, this guy was baptized in Jesus' name, filled with the Holy Ghost. I know that might mess with some, but let me tell you something. Make your calling and election sure. Make your calling and election sure. That's what he was. He wouldn't force it on you. But he would say to you, well, if Jesus got baptized, he would say that to you, but he wouldn't offend you. No. Not just, well, the Lord, he, you know, he got baptized. Jesus got baptized. He was submerged. See, I love you, but I can't turn over in my sleep at night and not say at least a little bit about what he might want you to hear. Because we know that it just takes a little bit of study and you get there on your own. Just a little bit. You get there on your own. See, because God loves you. He created you. He cares about you. And see, what Tunde kept in front of him was the thing that mattered most, and that was his relationship with God. Let me tell you what the benefits of a relationship with God will really truly do for you. It will make you a better husband, a better wife. It will make you a better parent. It would make you a better grandparent. It'll make you a better coworker. It'll make you a better subordinate to your boss. A relationship with God, when you put God first, everything else is going to start lining up. Or else he spanks you. So there's no such thing as, I can't serve God because I got to do this for my kid. You can serve God and you'll do everything that's right for your kid. But some things maybe you shouldn't be doing for your kid. See, when you serve God, when he's your Lord, you're giving him permission to correct your behaviors. So if your behavior is not right, he's going to want to correct that. The Lord is listening. He's inclined his ear to me, so let me start talking to him. I will serve the Lord in the presence of everyone. See, when I was saying that, everybody was there with me. But see, but what I'm trying to say to you is this drops down to being personal now. Will you really serve God? As far as I know, and I don't have a heaven or hell to place anybody in, but as far as I know, this guy's parked at the feet of Jesus. I can't put him in heaven. But from the way it appears to this preacher, you understand what I'm saying? Some preachers will preach a person right into heaven, and the people in the audience are saying, "Man, you know they ain't in no heaven." Far as I know, he didn't have any secret sins. His public walk, it was spot on. I say to you, he that endures to the end, the same shall be saved. That's what the scripture says. Let me leave you with this thought. There are like 60 plus scripture that talk about salvation. Just because one says this to be saved or that to be saved, get the collection. Get the full body of the work so that you can know. Because you can be baptized in Jesus' name, filled with the Holy Ghost, and still go to hell because the Lord will leave you because you won't change. Get the full body of the scripture, that part that says, he that endures to the end, the same shall be saved. From all appearances, Tunde's parked at the feet of Jesus. I like that thought. That thought goes well with me. Now I have to, see, I still am left here to endure to the end. How about you? How about you? What's on your Tuesday evening? What's on your Thursday evening? What you doing Monday night? You leave church on Sunday. What you gonna do? What you gonna do? Will you be serving God in your city before all the people? Hallelujah. Thank you. Jesus, we thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. No, she's going to tell you what song she's singing. You play with her, if that's okay. The one with these braids. Yeah. Come on up. House of Right. Come on up. Just go ahead and get in position.
We also pause and we're grateful for having our paths to cross and knowing him and we're grateful to have the opportunity to serve and honor him during this, his transition. As a small token of our appreciation, we'd like to present you this memorial tapestry.
How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? And all will see how great is our God. Oh, how great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? And all will see how great is our God.
Family members and friends, further services in the interment will take place at Graceland Memorial Park, located in Newcastle, Delaware. We do ask everyone that plans to go with us for interment services, after leaving the sanctuary, we ask that you might board your cars. We're asking all drivers in the procession to please utilize your headlights as well as your four-way flashers in the procession. At this time, I'd just like to make recognition of the flowers that have been sent. We have offerings with deepest sympathy from Mayor Dennis P. Williams in the city of Wilmington. We have a floor arranging to Dr. Durosomo from the OPPO USA. And we have the care spray, which was sent by Mr. Durosomo's children. At this time, we're going to ask everyone to stand. Pastor Seth will lead us in our recessional. If we can have six gentlemen assemble at the front doors of the church to act as casket bearers, we can have two ladies come forward to act as flower bearers.
Was in the air. Even though yet living, he was in someone else's care, calling him upward to a majestic place, something he looked forward to when he finished his race. And to answer that call, now he surely is gone. All heaven was there when they welcomed him home.